Let's come to God today here in the house of the Lord for worship. May I invite all of you to rise to your feet. For the Bible says in 1 Chronicles 16:23-31, sing to the Lord, all the earth, proclaim his salvation day after day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all peoples. For great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the nations are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and joy are in his dwelling place. Ascribe to the Lord, all you families of nations. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. The world is firmly established. It cannot be moved. Let the heavens rejoice. Let the earth be glad. Let them say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Amen.
Anything. As we come before you this Sunday, how great the chasm that lies between us We are great sinners, but we have an even greater Savior. And even as we prepare ourselves for Holy Week, each Sunday, God, as we gather, is a reminder that we serve a God who is our living hope, that the tomb is empty, that our God is risen and alive and working in all our lives. Lord, we just praise you and worship you. And we surrender our lives to you, in asking God that you help us. Just as you rescued us from the grave, you have broken every chain that binds us. The chains of sin, the chains of addiction, the chains of everything in the darkness. God, you have broken every chain, and there's salvation in your name. So help us, Lord, to pursue you like no other. Forgive us for all the times we have taken you for granted. Forgive us for all the times we have taken our salvation for granted. But here we are reminded, we are great sinners, but we have an even greater Savior. And so, God, we pray, humble us before you, lead us towards the cross, and help us, God, to truly follow you and worship you with all our lives. All this we ask and pray in the mighty name of our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated. Let us continue in a time of corporate prayer. And today is being the second Sunday of the month, we pray for the world. And we continue to pray for Myanmar. Right, the situation in Myanmar, as of now, what is reported in the news is over 70 protesters have been shot and killed by the police and the army. Right, and we know that these are peaceful protesters. I mean, they are not violent. They are not. They're just protesting against the military. And so, let us pray for peace. Let us pray for wisdom. For the military junta, right, so that they do not shoot their own people, right, who are protesting. Let us pray that there will be a face-saving way for them to step down or to reverse this coup, and that the people's lives will be spared, right, so there will be a peaceful resolution, right. So let's commit this country into God's hands, remembering that God is overall, trusting that he is still in control. So let's spend some time to pray for Myanmar, and then we will end by praying the Lord's Prayer together. Let's begin to round up our prayers. Let's join our hearts to pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Now it's time for scripture reading. Let us invite Brother Ethan to read the scripture for us today.
The scripture reading for today is Nehemiah 4, verses 1 to 23. When Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall, he became angry and was greatly incensed. He ridiculed the Jews, and in the presence of his associates and the army of Samaria, he said, "What are those feeble Jews doing? Will they restore their wall? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they finish in a day? Can they bring the stones back to life from those heaps of rubble, burnt as they are?" Tobiah the Ammonite, who was at his side, said, "What they are building, even a fox climbing up on it, will break down their walls of stones. Hear us, our God, for we are despised. Turn our insults back on their own heads. Give them over as plunder in the land of captivity. Do not cover up their guilt, or blurt out their sins from your sight, for they have thrown insults in the face of the builders. So we rebuilt the wall till all of it reached half its height, for the people worked with all their heart. But when Sanballat, Tobiah, the Arabs, the Ammonites, and the people of Ashdod heard that the repairs to Jerusalem's walls had gone ahead and that the gaps were being closed, they were very angry. They all plotted together to come and fight against Jerusalem and stir up trouble against it. But we prayed to our God and posted a guard day and night to meet this threat. Meanwhile, people in Judah said, 'The strength of the laborers is giving out, and there is so much trouble that we cannot rebuild the wall.' Also, our enemies said, 'Before they know it or see us, we will be right there among them, and we'll kill them and put an end to the work.' Then the Jews who lived near them came and told us 10 times over. Wherever you turn, they will attack us. Therefore, I stationed some of the people behind the lowest points of the wall at the exposed places, posting them by families with their swords, spears, and bows. After I looked things over, I stood up and said to the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people, 'Don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord, who is great and awesome, and fight for your families, your sons and your daughters, your wives and your homes.' When our enemies heard that we were aware of their plot and that God had frustrated it, we all returned to the wall, each to our own work. From that day on, half of my men did the work, while the other half were equipped with spears, shields, bows and armor. The officers posted themselves behind all the people of Judah who were building the wall. Those who carried materials did their work with one hand and held a weapon in the other, and each of the builders wore his sword at his side as he worked. But the man who sounded the trumpet stayed with me. Then I said to the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people, 'The work is extensive and spread out, and we are all widely separated from each other along the wall. Wherever you hear the sound of the trumpet, join us there. Our God will fight for us.' So we continued the work, with half the men holding spears, from the first light of dawn till the stars came out. At that time, I also said to the people, 'Have every man and his helpers stay inside Jerusalem at night, so they can serve us as guards by night and as workers by day. Neither I nor my brothers, nor my men, nor the guards with me took off our clothes. Each had his weapon, even when he went for water.' This is the word of God. Thanks be to God."
Good morning, church. Today we continue with Nehemiah 4, our sermon series on Nehemiah. And as you've heard Ethan read for us, we see that this whole chapter is a chapter about opposition. So we are going to look at how opposition faced by Nehemiah kept on growing and threatened to derail the whole wall building project. And we are also going to look at how Nehemiah responded and draw lessons from there for the opposition that we will face for our own lives. Now, we all know that hard times make us strong. Athletes train with weights because they provide resistance and opposition, which makes the muscles grow bigger and stronger. Now, we have more respect for a leader who has been through difficult times and overcame them to be where he or she is today, rather than for a leader from a privileged background who has had his or her life handed to him or her on a plate, sailing smoothly throughout and untested to a high position of leadership. Why? Because we know that difficult times make us grow, develop us, and train us in ways that can never happen if we have it smooth sailing all the way. And just let me say it from the beginning here, that as we seek to follow Jesus in this world, we will face opposition. Right? Satan is not going to sit back and relax and give us a free hand. You can be sure that he will try all ways and means to make you give up following Jesus. If he can't do it by hardship and suffering, maybe he will do it by comfort and prosperity. But first, let's look more closely at the opposition that Nehemiah faced. So let's recap, right? These are the three main enemies that were mentioned, right, in Nehemiah. Who were these people? Now, Sanballat, let me begin with Sanballat. He's the main character. He's a Babylonian name. His name is Babylonian in origin. And at the time of Nehemiah, he was the governor of Samaria, right, which was Israel's neighbor. And we are also told that his daughter married one of the grandsons of the high priest Eliashib at that time. So he's in a sense related by marriage. Okay, but again, remember that the Jews are not supposed to intermarry, right? They're not supposed to marry people from other tribes, other nations, right? They were supposed to marry within the Jews themselves. Now, Tobiah was actually a Jewish name, but he was an Ammonite, which was a traditional enemy of Israel. So his name actually meant that Yahweh is good. It's probably an adopted Jewish name. Now, from Nehemiah's, from the book of Nehemiah, we also know that he was closely associated with Eliashib, the high priest. And he was like a favorite among the priests. Now, Geshem was an Arab. He ruled a group of Arabian tribes who had taken over Edom and Moab, which was on the east of the Jordan River. And so this is a map that I've shown before. Okay, Samaria is up here. Ammon, the Tobiah, the Ammonite, was controlled Ammon here. And Geshem, the Arab, right, was on the east of the Jordan River, the areas. So you can see that Israel was actually surrounded by these enemies who did not want her to be strong. They want to profit from her weakness, maybe trade at an advantage over her and all that, right? So when the rebuilding of the walls first started and Sanballat heard about it, he became furious. This is today's reading. He became furious and his reaction was to mock the Jews, right, in the presence of his brothers and the wealthy men of Samaria. The wealthy men of Samaria can also be interpreted as the army of Samaria, right? So there's some parts that's not clear in the Hebrew word, right? So it can be interpreted either way. So Ethan was reading from NIV, which interpreted it as the army of Samaria, right? So this is from NASB that says it's the wealthy men of Samaria. So he poked fun at them, calling them feeble and weak, basically saying that, oh, all your rebuilding efforts will amount to nothing. The burnt stones cannot be revived because they are already weak, right? The burnt stones. Now, Tobiah the Ammonite was with Sanballat and he added his own insult as well. So he ridiculed the efforts of the Jews, saying that even if a fox quite light lah, right, compared to a human, right, even if a fox should jump on the wall that they were rebuilding, it would collapse. But so far, as you have noticed, they have not gone further than insults. Right? So their comments, of course, their comments in the end were not confined to the wealthy men of Samaria, for Nehemiah and the builders certainly heard it. And of course, it demoralized them, right? As we see in verses 4 to 5, right? Which Nehemiah was a prayer from Nehemiah. So he prayed, "Oh God, hear, O our God, how we are despised, how we are an object of contempt. Return their taunting on their own heads. Give them over as plunder in the land of captivity. Do not cover up their guilt or blot out their sins from your sight. For they have thrown insults in the face of builders." Right, so we notice that the very first thing that Nehemiah did when he heard these insults, when he faced this opposition, is that he prayed to God. Right, so that's very important. But some of us, as we read the words of his prayer, may be uncomfortable by the words of his prayer. Right? Is it okay for us to say such prayers? Now, this is not unique to Nehemiah, right? There are many psalms in the Bible where we see or we read of the psalmist praying for God's punishment upon his enemies. So is it okay for us to pray such prayers? Now, let me make some remarks on this as an aside. Now, first, the words of these prayers, whether it's Nehemiah or the psalms that we read, show us again that we can be perfectly honest before our God with our feelings and our emotions. Sometimes the pain and the suffering that our enemies inflict on us are just too much to bear, and it can incur much anger and wrath at them. Imagine one of the protesters' family, right? One of the protesters in Myanmar who's killed, and how the family would feel, right? Because they protested, they are without weapons, and they're shot in cold blood by the army, right? But again, right, just as I've mentioned earlier on with Psalms of Lament, right, the prayer, we note, is directed to God. Nehemiah does not seek any revenge on his own. He does not attack the enemy, right? He does not take matters into his own hands. He brings the whole situation before God, pours out his anger, and then he lets God deal with it. Now, secondly, it is also important to note that in the Old Testament, God identifies himself very closely with his people, Israel. And therefore, any insults directed at Israel is also directed at God himself. Right? It's the same, it's equivalent to insulting God. And so, this also is part of the reason why Nehemiah prays the prayer that he did. He was angry both for his people and for his God. But ultimately, we must also reconcile this with many commands in the New Testament, which instruct us to bless those who persecute us, to overcome evil with good, and even to love our enemies. And of course, we have the ultimate example of Jesus, who died for his enemies, who died for sinners on the cross. So how do we make sense of Nehemiah's prayer in light of the New Testament? So I think we must recognize that the vengeful prayers of Nehemiah and the psalmist were prompted, firstly, right, by the insecurity, by an underlying insecurity. What is this insecurity about? They do not know whether good will finally triumph. They do not know whether the righteous will finally be rewarded and the wicked punished. So this insecurity is inevitable until the cross revealed the full extent of God's unquenchable love for humanity, right? And that as a whole stood in enmity against him, and until the empty tomb could proclaim God's final triumph over evil through love. And so we realize that it is only within the triumph of the cross that we are able to love our enemies and to truly bless those who persecute us. Of course, it doesn't mean that we will always be able to do so, for I'm sure that we will admit that we have often repaid evil for evil as well. When people do bad things to us, we do bad things to them in return. But the point I'm making here is that it is the cross and the empty tomb that gives us the assurance that we can go ahead and love our enemies, that everything will be put right in the end. And this was an assurance that Nehemiah and the psalmist did not yet experience in their time. And perhaps that's why it gives rise to such vengeful prayers. Right? Now coming back to our text, we see that although Sanballat and Tobias' insults demoralized the builders, but it didn't deter them from the work. And verse 6 tells us that they built the entire wall to half its height, for the people had a mind to work. Or in the NIV, they worked with all their heart. Of course, when Sanballat and Tobiah and all the other enemies of Israel heard that, they grew even more angry. And so they upped their game. Now, instead of throwing insults at the builders, they threatened violence. Right, so they conspired in verse 11 and 12. They conspired to come together to attack Jerusalem. And they spread the news, making sure that Nehemiah and the builders heard it. Not only that, even the Jews who lived near the builders came and told them 10 times, which basically means repeatedly, over and over again. Right? So the Hebrew that's translated as 10 times just means that it's over and over again. They came to tell them, they are going to come up against us from every place where you may turn. Right, so who are these Jews who live near them? Right, so you must realize that at the time, because the city walls of Jerusalem were broken, right, hardly anyone stayed in Jerusalem city itself. Right, most of the Jews lived in surrounding areas near Jerusalem, but they were not in Jerusalem itself. And so when the builders came, when Nehemiah mobilized the builders to come and build, right, most likely, right, all these builders are living, their own homes are around Jerusalem. Right, and so these Jews who live near them came and tell them, I believe these would be their own family members. Right, being concerned, wow, my husband is building the wall, but now I'm hearing all these rumors, these enemies are going to attack. So of course I'll be very worried. I'll keep coming to him and say, hey, they're going to attack us. You know, maybe you should stop or what. Right? So all the families of the builders were probably around, very near Jerusalem, but not in Jerusalem itself. Right? So, but we see that this time, earlier the insults didn't seem to affect them too much because the threats of the enemies affected them more badly, right? So this was said in Judah, right? The strength of the laborers is giving up. There is so much rubble that we cannot rebuild the wall. And this news was being spread all over Judah. So can you imagine what it would have been like if you were one of the builders? Even if the original insults did not demoralize you, surely you will be demoralized now, right? When you reach this stage, when you hear all that. Right, so, as I mentioned, right? So with the threat of the violence and the spread of rumors all around, now the builders were really afraid. Now Nehemiah, being very much on the ground, he knew all that was happening and he stepped in to provide leadership. So look at how he responded this time. We prayed to our God, and because of them, we set up a guard against them day and night. Now, besides that, he also spoke to them to encourage them. Look at what he said. So when I saw their fear, right, so this tells us that this time round, the builders were really afraid. Earlier, maybe they managed to brush off the insults and continue to work. But this time it was serious because their lives were being threatened. The enemy was threatening to attack them. So Nehemiah could see their fear. Right, so he rose and spoke to them, the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people. Do not be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome, and fight for your brothers, your sons, your daughters, your wives, and your houses. So we see what Nehemiah did in his speech. But first, he reminded them of the Lord who is great and awesome, and therefore there was no need to fear the enemies. And then he gave them motivation, additional motivation to defend their ground by reminding them of who they are fighting for, not just for God, but their own families and even their own houses. You know, that's how they motivate us to train in national service, when we serve, right? You must fight for your country, right? Maybe country not strong enough. You must fight for your family, right? Your parents, your wives, your children, right? So that's how they motivate us to train in national service. And that's a really strong motivation, right? Sometimes when you feel like giving up, you say, wow, I must defend my family. Okay, then you continue, right? So after praying and reminding the people of the Lord who is great and awesome, Nehemiah then set up various defensive measures, right? This is what he did, right? So I'll just briefly go through, right? So he stationed men at the lowest points of the wall, at the most dangerous part, at the most exposed places, and he stationed them by their families, because you are most likely going to fight to the death for your family, right? With all their swords, spears, and bows. Now he split his servants into two teams. Half of them carried on the work of building the walls. The other half were armed with the spears, shields, bows, and breastplates. So this other half that were armed, I presume that they were doing the patrolling and were supposed to be the first responders to any attack. Now at this point, it's good to know that Nehemiah calls, there's two different groups of people. One is the builders, and one is the group that Nehemiah refers to as my men or my servants in the NASB. Right, so these are two different groups. Right, so these servants that he split into two teams do not refer to the builders, but a small group of trained men who, I don't know for what reason, the scripture doesn't say clearly, but they owe their allegiance to Nehemiah. They were specific, especially loyal to Nehemiah, and will do whatever he says. So their status is clearly higher than the normal builders or normal servant. So this is a group that is distinguished from the builders. Now as for the builders, each of them also wore their sword, his sword by his side as he built. And Nehemiah also had a trumpeter with him. Right? At whatever place the trumpet sounds, right, everyone is supposed to gather there, because that's where the enemy is. You know what this means? It means that Nehemiah had every intention of being in the thick of action. Right? Because the trumpeter is with Nehemiah, and Nehemiah's instruction is, wherever the trumpet sounds, all of you are supposed to rally there. That means that's where the enemy is attacking. So we see that Nehemiah is not hiding in some HQ control tower, like playing chess, right? Ordering this army to move. No, he's right there in the thick of action. He aims to be right there when the enemy attacks, right? And then finally, he also urged the builders to spend the night in Jerusalem. Remember, they don't leave in Jerusalem, right? So usually, probably after work, they go back to their surrounding homes to spend the night. But now he is encouraging them to spend the night in Jerusalem so that it could be guarded by night as well. Now because of these measures, the people were able to carry on with the work. But surely it was very much slower than before, but the work continued. And Nehemiah also reported that when the enemies learned of all these defensive measures, and because of that, God frustrated the enemy's plan. Right, so as mentioned earlier, this entire chapter of Nehemiah focuses on the opposition that he encountered when rebuilding the walls of Jerusalem. And this was a calling which God had put in his heart. Remember, at the very beginning, his heart broke when he heard the news about the broken walls of Jerusalem. Right, and it also shows us how he responded to the growing opposition. And thus, I think it is fair for us to draw some lessons regarding opposition that we ourselves will face in our lives when we try to do what pleases God, or when we try to fulfill God's calling for our lives. Now, we generally call this opposition that we face spiritual warfare, right? As a reminder that our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, powers, world forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness, right, in the heavenly places. But there are two qualifications we must be aware of. Right, first, even though we may call this opposition spiritual warfare, don't expect the opposition we face to appear as an ugly, evil spirit, obviously bad or obviously evil, right, to fight us. Spiritual warfare or opposition often take on very earthly, physical forms, right? In people or situations that oppose us or frustrate us. This makes sense because we are made of flesh and blood after all. And secondly, we encounter spiritual warfare or opposition only when we are trying to do God's will, trying to fulfill His calling for our lives, trying to do what pleases Him. Why? Because this obviously angers Satan, who is totally opposed to God. And so you can be sure he will do everything he can to stop you. But please note, right? So please note that not everything that goes against you is to be called spiritual opposition or warfare. Right? Especially not when you do something wrong and are punished for it. Right? So if you commit a crime and you go to jail for it, please don't say that that is spiritual opposition. Right? That is because you deserve it, because you did something wrong and you are being punished for it. Right? So as we consider the lessons, how we can react to opposition, spiritual opposition in our lives, we must take note of these two points. Right? So having said that, what are the lessons we can draw from Nehemiah 4? Right? I would like to suggest two. First, as I have mentioned, opposition is to be expected when we do what pleases God, when we try to fulfill God's calling for our lives. Right? I know I have already mentioned this earlier, but I just want to clarify this applies to all of life. Right? So it's not just pastors or missionaries or full-time ministry workers who seem to be obviously doing God's work. It's not only them who will face opposition. As you try to be a good husband to your wife, as you try to be a good son or a good daughter to your parents, as you try to be a good parent, right, to your children, you will face opposition. Right, there will be forces at work to draw you away, to tempt you, to distract you. So too, when you try to be right, godly parents to your children, when you try to pass on your faith to them, you will encounter opposition. And at work, when you try to do what pleases God, maybe you refuse to take part in some unethical practices, you too will face opposition. One particular area that I believe is already here and will increase in the coming days is the cancel culture, right, that is so prevalent in US, in America. Right, this is when someone does something or says something wrong, in the sense, by wrong I don't mean it's necessarily wrong in a moral sense, but wrong in the sense that it offends some people or is viewed as insensitive or intolerant, then because of this one comment or action, this person is cancelled. In that sense, what is cancelled means? It means erased, treated as invisible, deemed as worthless, completely ignored, viewed as having nothing to contribute at all. Of course, this is not new, right? Since beginning of time, people have been writing off others, right? But what makes this cancel culture so prominent and scary and dangerous is the extent of it now, right? The explosion of social media in recent years. But so last time you cancel someone means you just ignore this person, right? And maybe you tell other people, a few other people, yeah, this person not worth listening to, forget it, right? Let's write him off. But now with social media, the whole world can see your comments, right? And then you just deleting this person, right? And there is a growing tendency for the bigger and wider culture to cancel Christians and the Christian point of view. Now, I hope to share more about this in a later sermon, but I believe this is one area of growing opposition that we Christians will face as we try to be salt and light in this world. And again, such opposition is spiritual in nature, although it takes very real physical and tangible forms. Right? Now, the second lesson we can learn is that when dealing with opposition, we should first bring it to God in prayer. Like what Nehemiah did, each time he responded first in prayer. But after that, prayer must lead to action. We see in Nehemiah's situation, there is an interplay of God's sovereignty and human responsibility. Right? Nehemiah entrusted the whole situation to God, but he made sure that he acted and did whatever he could to defend the walls against the enemy. And when the enemy's plans were frustrated, Nehemiah credited it to God, not to himself. In this sense, brothers and sisters, prayer and action are not to be seen as two different things or two separate things. They are intricately linked together. We must turn first to God in prayer, and then things happen when we pray. When we pray, it is not just self-talk, talking to yourself, or it's not just empty talk. Why? Because God is real, and He hears our prayers. So most of us who have experienced when we pray, sometimes we experience God changing us, changing our mind, changing our heart, or softening our hearts towards something, towards a person that we harbor a grudge against. Right? When we pray, God can change us. And sometimes when we pray, God can change our circumstances. And God can give us wisdom and insight to deal with our problems differently. And then we must act on what God has revealed to us through prayer. And this is the main way God has chosen to work, through imperfect, broken, and often sinful people like you and me. But God would not do it any other way. And so will you make up your mind to do what is pleasing to God and face up to the opposition that will surely come your way when you do that? Will you learn from Nehemiah to keep praying and carry on? Now, make no mistake about it. The opposition will affect you, just like the opposition affected the builders. Maybe the first round, it didn't affect them too much because the first round were just words and were just insults. But the second round, they threatened violence. And as I've shown you in the verse just now, when Nehemiah saw their fear. So, it's not like when we make up our mind to do God's work, we will surely be able to face up to the opposition. The opposition will affect you. The warfare will surely make you afraid, make you fear for your life, may even cause real damage or real harm to you. But what we learn from Nehemiah is to keep praying and carry on. You see, brothers and sisters, God's work done in God's way will always face opposition from the devil. But we can also be sure that it will never lack God's supply. And so make up your mind to do what pleases the Lord today. And surrender the problems and oppositions that will come your way. Surrender them to the Lord. Because we are reminded that God's work, when done in God's way, will never lack God's supply. The next slide. The last slide. Anyway, it's just a phrase there, right, by Hudson Taylor. God's work, when done in God's way, will never lack God's supply, even though opposition will come our way. And so will you keep praying and carry on like Nehemiah did? Let us go to God in prayer. Brothers and sisters, as we go to God in prayer, just take some time to pause before the Lord. Are you facing any opposition in your life because you're trying to do the Lord's will, because you're trying to do what pleases the Lord, whether it is in your family or in your workplace or in school? Would you bring it to the Lord in prayer, like what Nehemiah did? But as you do so, you are supposed to carry on in the good work that you are doing. Keep praying and carry on, because there is an element of our own human responsibility combined with God's sovereignty. And so make up your mind to do what pleases the Lord today, to persevere, to continue doing it, knowing and expecting that there will be opposition, but yet knowing and being comforted by the fact that God's work done in God's way will never lack God's supply. God, we stand before your word this morning in Nehemiah. We acknowledge, God, that as we try to follow you in this world, as we try to do what pleases you, whether in our homes, our schools, or in our workplaces, in our families, the devil is not happy with them. Because all he wants is to oppose you. He doesn't like strong families. He doesn't like us seeing our work as a calling to please you, to glorify you. He doesn't want our relationships to flourish. And so, Lord, we can be sure that he will do all he can to oppose all the good that you want us to do in this world. So, God, we come before you, we acknowledge that we will face opposition. But we also come before you and we are reminded that the tomb is empty, that our Lord is our living hope, that our Lord is our risen Lord and Savior who has overcome the cross and the grave, and that you are with us. And so, God, we are reminded today that God's work, when done in God's way, will never lack God's supply. So I pray for my brothers and sisters here. Some of them may be going through a difficult time, facing spiritual opposition as they try to do what pleases you. I pray that they will experience your supply of grace, your supply of perspective, wisdom, and strength to face up to the spiritual opposition that they are surrounded by. And I pray that, Lord, you will just give us strength and courage to continue to follow you in this world. And because of the opposition that we face, show us how we can be here for one another, to strengthen and to encourage one another through our fellowship, through our life of worship together as a church. So we give ourselves to you, pray and ask all this in the name of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord and Savior.
Now it's time for offering. Let's prepare our hearts. As you come forward for the offering, please remember to maintain social distancing. The PayNow QR code is on the left and right hand side of the wall, where you can do your giving via the PayNow. May I invite all of you to stand and let's read aloud the offering prayer. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you that we can always trust in you. You are an abundant God, and out of your great mercy, you have given us so much. We give you this offering today. With it, we worship you and give our whole self to you. Please now take it and use it for your kingdom and your glory. Extend and multiply its reach and influence, we pray. May it be a great blessing to many. We ask all this in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. Please be seated. Now it's time for family news. There's a couple of family news. There's quite a fair bit today, so please be patient with me. Okay, the first one is Social Concern Sunday, which is next week, 21st March. We will be collecting a second offering. So what are we, what is CAC doing with this second offering? It is going to be distributed to these 10 services and organization according by percentage. Okay, so from Ang Mo Kio Chinese Methodist Church, they are Senior Activity Center. Changi Methodist Church, they are Punggol Preaching Point. Caris Methodist for also their Senior Activity Center. Geylang Methodist, the Green Tops Senior Activity Center. SAC is Senior Activity Center. So also to Sengkang Methodist Church, their MWS Senior Activity Center. One Hope Center, Prison Fellowship Singapore, Breakthrough Mission, and Board of Social Concern General Fund, and also the MWS Chaplaincy. Yeah. So these are the 10 beneficiaries for the second offering. So pray about it in the week and prepare the second offering for next week. Right? The next one is we're going to have quiz on Nehemiah, the book of Nehemiah. Okay, so our Discipleship and Nurture Committee actually prepared the quizzes, and there will be attractive prizes to be won. For the English quizzes, the questions will be available for collection next Sunday. So look out for this quiz and let's join for, you know, time off, you know, getting yourself, you know, prepare and see how much you already have learned from the book of Nehemiah. Okay, and this month's church prayer meeting will be held on the 30th of March, Tuesday, 7:45 p.m. via Zoom. The link will be sent out via the WhatsApp chat group. If you're not in any group, you can contact Reverend Florence or myself to get the chat, the Zoom link itself. So usually we'll send out on that day once the link is out. Okay. Next is the Easter Baptism Confirmation and Transfer Membership. If you wanted to do your baptism, confirmation, or transfer membership this coming Easter, please obtain a form from Reverend Florence or Reverend Edmund. Do it as soon as possible because they need to prepare for the classes and also for this Easter baptism. Yeah. Okay, and take note for our Holy Week service. Okay, time passes very fast. In about 2 weeks' time, we'll come to Easter. Okay, so Good Friday service is on 2nd April and Easter Sunday is on the 4th April. Both combined service will be held at 10 a.m. Okay, and you can register the attendance for the slot at our usual combined service, the Eventbrite link. Okay, so after the service, I will send it through the WhatsApp group if you have missed out this part. All right, and the Thanksgiving offering we've been collecting since 13 December last year to 14th February this year. Praise the Lord, hallelujah. And we have come up with this Thanksgiving offering of an amount of 73,567. Yeah, and may all these funds be put into good use and yeah, for the work of our Lord. Okay. Next, I'll invite Reverend Edmund to talk about this COVID-19 memorial service.
Okay, so this COVID-19, now we know that 4th of April is Easter Sunday, and also it also coincides with the Chinese Qingming festival. And we know that last year, actually, from our church, 7 brothers and sisters went home to be with the Lord last year. And because of COVID restrictions, it was very difficult for church members who wanted to come and pay their last respects, to attend the wake service and all that. And so we decided, the pastoral team, we decided that this year we would do a one-off memorial service for all our brothers and sisters who passed away last year during the time of COVID. Okay, and so out of the 7 families that I've contacted, 4 families are going to take part, 3 families, due to various inconveniences and difficulties, they are chosen not to take part. Okay, so we are going to have memorial service for Ya Zhuan. Alright, that's the first family. The second family is family of Mr. Cheong Tiang Guan, our Hokkien service member. His wife is Ah Hun Ji. Right, some of you might know, she stays in West Coast area. Right, the third is our family of Xiu Hua Ji, right, Madam Chua Xiu Hua, her family will be taking part. And finally, the family of Madam Lucy Ho. Madam Lucy Ho is a 100-year-old lady who just passed away in the end of last year. Okay, and so it is a chance for the church to pay their respects and to give thanks for the lives of these members. And so representatives of each of these four families will be here. The service will be held here. And so I encourage you, right, to sign up and be here for this service as well. As part of the church, they are part of our body, and so we want to hold this memorial service for them. And so you can sign up through this link. All right. So we will keep it to 100 pax for that day. Right. And so there will be some seats reserved for the family members, and the rest of you can just come. Right. So sign up for this memorial service. So that's it for this.
Okay, so same thing. I will later on after the service send this registration link to the WhatsApp chat group. So just register and come and support the family and keep them in prayer too. Right? And the last item is about the Methodist message online. If you have been following our chat group, we already sent this link for you to register for the e-copy of the Methodist message. So please, I will encourage all of you to go and sign up for this, that you can read it on the go on your phone itself. Right? May I invite all of you to rise and prepare for the hymn of sending forth. Yeah, I'm very sorry, there's no sound. So we'll meditate as the words is played on. As the lyrics go, for every time I pray, I move the hand of God. Prayer does the things that our hands cannot do. And for every time we pray, the mountains are removed, the paths are made straight, and nations turn to you. And indeed, our prayers can do wonders. No matter what we do in our life, go to Lord in prayer first before we move our first step. As we meditate the word, even though, Lord, there's no sound, there's no music, but we come to you with our pure heart, we come to you in prayer, we want to seek your face, and we want to stand within the gap, and there will I intercede. Because every time as we pray, we move the hand of God, and prayer is able to do things that our hands cannot do. And every time we pray, the mountains are removed, the paths are made straight, and nations turn to you. And the verse 2 goes on that, yes, indeed, Lord, only through you we gain our strength. So continue to guide us with your gracious hand. There will be victory. And every time we come to you in prayer, we move the hand of God. Prayer is wondrous, and that's the things that our hands cannot do. And for every time we come to you in prayer, the obstacles in front of us are removed, the path are made straight, and the nations turn to you. And amen.
Let us receive the benediction. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you now and always. Amen. Service is over. God bless you. See you next week.
Okay, just to remind all of you, we have our English Adult Fellowship today because it's the second Sunday. So every second and fourth Sunday will be our fellowship. It's held at 10:15 at the school canteen. And today we are celebrating the birthday of our church members. So we welcome all of you to join us in the school canteen for the celebration.